Hello, everybody. Happy Friday. My name is Lee Rudnicki. I'm an entertainment lawyer, film producer, and writer. I'm based in Los Angeles and Italy. Last year, I did this seminar from Italy. It was a lot different experience. I'm in LA. Very happy to be here. Thank you for the opportunity. My presentation today is going to have five components, the quick overview. I'm going to explain how and why this may, in fact, be the most valuable hour of your legal career, why you should listen to me. Second, I'm going to talk about the System 7, I call it, that I have developed, which is for, initially I developed it to do well in law school and took that into the bar exam, and I codified it in my book, which we'll talk about a little bit later. Third, I'm going to talk about mental preparation, which is half of the battle of getting through this bar exam summer. We're going to talk about a theory that I developed. It's, I guess, more than a theory, a methodology called time wall theory, the concept of time walls. And then we're going to look at the bar exam itself, the three components, the MBE, the essay exams, and the performance exams. And I'm going to explain to you how to knock out each of those three components. Okay, first, a quick word to anyone out there who may be in the category of scared, worried, tired, broke, indifferent, wondering what you're doing, how you're going to survive this summer. I'm going to tell you how to do that. That's part of the success of my system through the last few years has really been a focus on how to get through this experience, not only successfully, but that you have a really, really great time in the process. And that sounds completely counterintuitive, but I'm gonna get to that in a second. And if you're wondering why you should be a lawyer, this is not the time or place to have those thoughts right now. But I will tell you one thing. If you are thinking in your brain right now, gee, I wish I should be sailing in the Mediterranean right now instead of taking this crazy exam and becoming a lawyer, which doesn't sound fun, I will tell you right now, the quickest way in your life to get from point A to point B, which sailing in the Mediterranean or whatever you want to do, is to get through this exam. And I'm going to teach you how to do that in a way that is not going to be the worst experience of your life. It might, in fact, be the best if you do it correctly. So one caveat. If you, in the last year and a half, second half of second year, third year, if you have C's on your report card, you know, that typically essay exams where you did not get above a C plus, you're stuck in the C zone. This seminar is a red alert. Turn off your phone, focus with all you have, because statistically you're going to fail the bar. So I'm going to show you how to not do that, but that's the biggest red alert going into the summer if you haven't figured out essays yet, but I'm going to show you that. So don't get worried. We're going to go through it all step by step. Now, for 3 minutes, I'm going to tell you how and why my system works. It's a little bit different. It's off the beaten path. It's very successful, and it makes for a much different bar exam experience. So let me tell you how I created this system. So once upon a time in the 90s, I was a rudimental drummer. I was one of the best in the world, and that was my world. That's all I knew. At one point, I was ranked third in the world, doing this, going on tour, doing all these things. And then I had an experience in the 95 where I was shot at. Now, in today's world, that's just a Tuesday, but back then it was pretty scary. And it led to me making a lot of life decisions. I was unscathed, thank God. But I decided, you know, I didn't know a lot about the world. I wanted to go to law school. I wanted to just learn. So I stumbled into law school, the University of San Francisco, got off a tour, literally put my drumsticks on the shelf, went to class. Day one, the professor starts talking about the plaintiff. I had no clue what she was talking about. That's the level that I started law school in. I did not have a computer. Now, this was the 90s. It's not that crazy as it is now to not have a computer, but I didn't even know how to turn one on. I didn't know how to write. I didn't know what a plaintiff was. So, but here I was in law school. So off we went. 4 weeks in, my legal reading, writing and research professor pulls me aside and says, "Hey, what are you doing here? He became my friend and a valuable mentor later, but this was a reality check. This is like, you're not qualified to be here. You're going to fail out." And my response to that, and this is how I came to figure out the bar exam, was first response was, "You know what? You don't get to tell me that. I just had this life experience and I came to do law school and you don't get to judge what I'm capable of." I mean, I said that in a very nice way. Then I went into study mode. For 2.5 months, I studied more than anyone I have ever met in my life in that period of time doing anything. It was not even healthy how much I studied. And I learned every fact of every case. And I went into final exams ready to knock it out of the park. I mean, I had studied not round the clock. My girlfriend broke up with me. It was one crazy thing after another. All I did was study. Final exams come. I think I did great. Lo and behold, the grades come back. I have C plus, C plus, C plus, B minus, and maybe another B minus something, whatever. So that is, oh my God, I have no more time to put into this activity. And I'm below mediocre. I'm barely honorable mention law student. So I went to my professor's, CIPRO professor's office, and I said, "Hey, I'd like to see my exam." He brought the exam back. And on my C plus exam, I expected tons and tons of legal analysis, points and lunar calculus, whatever. What I saw on that exam was three words written in pencil, red pencil. Two of them was, "It is," with the question mark. And at that moment, first there was 30 seconds of rage, to be perfectly frank, because I thought, wow, all of that led to this. And then I realized, you know what? My grades are consistent. And these are great lawyers and great professors. I love my classes. This wasn't some kind of, so it didn't compute. And I realized I had no more time. No one could tell me, "Hey, you needed to study more." It wasn't possible, literally. So then I dedicated myself to learning, okay, how do you do well in law school? What is the game here? Obviously, they're playing football. I showed up to play baseball. No clue. So I focused and I took every exam seminar I could. I interviewed professors, I outlined exams, and I started to create a game plan, which I'm sharing with you today. My second semester, my grades bumped up. I was in the B range. I kept going. I went to Prague for the summer with the summer abroad and learning all these amazing things. I come back, same game plan. I implement the same plan, same strategy. My grades go up again. Second semester, spring, I get straight A's. I run the table. Third year, I get hired to teach contracts by the SBA, the Student Bar Association. I'm teaching a class, teaching law school to this day, off and on. So the thing I took away from that is, and the thing that you should know about the bar exam, first law school, and then bar exam, because it's the same thing. I took the same system to the bar exam and boom, it was easy. I knocked it out. What you need to take away from this is, it's not about how smart you are. Because when I got those C pluses and I'm looking around at my buddies, I wasn't around Albert Einstein and his twins. I was around people like me. We're just a bunch of smart people, whatever. So it's really about learning the system and learning the game plan to get through each step. And you have to accept that and you have to understand. And if you're getting C's in your transcripts in law school, you haven't learned that lesson yet. And you will. And right now, the red alert needs to be going off, because if you don't learn that lesson now, guess what you're going to be doing in 6 months? You're going to rewind play. You're going to be living the Groundhog Day movie, and it's not going to be that fun. Okay, so that's what's going on, and that's why you should listen to me for this hour. Quick note, this is a supplement I am teaching you how to study for the bar and how to prepare for it. The what you have to study, the substantive law, you're going to get out of your class, which is typically the MBE class and then another bar review class over the course of the summer. If there is anyone out there wondering, should I take a class? Should I not take the class? The answer is take the class. And that answer is the same whether you just got out of school or you've been a lawyer for 20 years and you think you know everything and you're ready to just smash it out of the park. The class will give you a schedule. It'll give you consistency and it'll give you the latest and greatest, everything what's going on. You can absolutely not ditch that class and think you're going to get through the bar by yourself, in my opinion. Okay. Now, I talked a lot about, you know, how I studied so much and then I changed the game plan. So the first element I looked at, because I read books on athletic performance, academic performance, I did a deep dive into, okay, how do you knock out an exam? You get one chance. It's like going to the Olympics. You fail, you're out. It doesn't matter. You wait a year, 4 years, whatever you're in. So to prepare for the summer, step number one, acknowledge success. Take a second and realize that just to get here, watching this video, you had to take the LSAT, you had to apply to schools, you had to get accepted to schools, you had to find money, you had to change your life in some great way, go to school, take the MPRE, whatever, and then the moral character determination, not so fun, graduate, very fun, and here you are. You climbed Mount Everest already. So step one, I think, before you go down this path of running down the bar exam, is you have to take a second and just stop. And feel good and go, you know what? Out of 100 people who say they want to do that, one did. That's me. And you did. So if you haven't celebrated that yet, do it right now. Take the dinner, do whatever you need to do, go to the beach. Take that day for yourself where you're not worried about the bar. You're just raising the flag, victory. You're going to need it. It's a good thing to do. Now, after you've done that, step two is to take everything from law school. All your insecurities, all of your anything you didn't like, anything you liked, your notes, you have to understand that it's all irrelevant now. It has nothing to do with your bar exam experience. That was Act One. Act Two is the bar exam. It's a new game, new rules, and new everything. So you have to forgive anybody who wronged you, any grades you didn't get, whatever, let it all go. Just forgive and forget and move on into this next journey. Step three, and being self-centered and selfish, unless you're in Hollywood, right? You see, being self-centered and selfish is not a good thing. For purposes of the bar exam, it's a requirement. You have to accept the fact that from now until the day you take the bar, your life is about you, period. And you have to be able to make those decisions once you decide your schedule that you're not going to let outside forces influence that. The caveat here, if you have kids, right, if you have children you have to deal with, then you're going to have to adjust what I'm telling you in terms of schedule. It can be done. It's done by millions of people. You're going to have to adjust that. But I'm assuming for purposes of this discussion that you have this block of time during the summer and you don't have a lot of outside things that you have to juggle. Fourth, prepare to compete. And by compete, there's two things that I tell students right off the bat. Number one, the bar exam pass rate, I'm always baffled as to why anybody spends more than 5 seconds wondering about that. It's like the gross national product of Peru in the year 5368, whatever. It's the most ridiculous, irrelevant piece of information that could possibly have anything to do with your summer experience. If the bar exam pass rate is 50% or 49%, what does that mean? You study 1% less? No. So advice number one, forget about it, period. Don't even listen. Pay attention after you take the bar. You won't care then anyway. Number two is your competitors. A lot of people go into the bar exam and start looking around. Is Bob learning torts today? Maybe I should learn torts today, or they're ahead of me. Step two, take anybody and everybody that you know in the world that's taken the bar exam and forget about them. Your study group is over. It will slow you down and you will fail the bar. Forget study group right now, right? Now, the competitors, your so-called competitors, you're getting ready to compete, but your only competition is with yourself, right? The NFL, Pittsburgh Steelers, they could put on the helmet, they can go out in the field, and they can impact their competitors. They can sack the quarterback, win the game. God bless America. They've done their thing. Olympic ice skating, that's an indirect competition. You go out, you skate, you're done. You cannot legally affect anyone else in the competition, right? It is what it is. Law student, same thing. If you're thinking about anybody else who's taking the bar exam, you're in the wrong game. If you're sitting in the bar review class wondering how they're going to do, not relevant to your life. You're not even going to see them when they take the bar exam anyway. They're going to be maybe even in another city. Who knows? Okay. Step five out of the seven steps to get ready for this madness and the bar exam is to smile. Because my program, I inherently believe and I proved it is in your best interest to have fun. And I don't use that word lightly. If you're in a good mental state taking the bar exam, if you have a routine that incorporates free time and fun things, which I'm going to show you, you're way more likely to pass, right? The fact that the bar exam has to be this miserable summer of, you know, dirge, let everybody think that's what you're doing. That's not what you're doing. That's a recipe for disaster and burnout. It's not what you're going to do. Okay, step six. I ask my students to make a commitment to yourself. It's basically in my book, I wrote it out, looking in the mirror and basically promising yourself, nobody else, who cares about anybody else? You. I promise to give 150% effort to passing the bar exam. I'll give my best every day. Nothing but my health and safety will be more important. And if I fail, so what? That's your personal mantra for this summer. You're not worried about failing. You're not worried about some fictitious pass rate. If you worry about failing, you'll fail. Let it go. You're going to pass the exam and you're going to have a good time doing it. The final step of mental preparation, and I will not use the actual word for purposes of this, but basically when I was taking the bar exam, and you hit these moments where you just look at what you have to memorize or whatever it is. And you go, there's no way. There's not enough time. I'm tired, whatever. You'll have a million excuses that'll line up for you to use. So what I did when my confidence was down is I took a big piece of paper and I wrote on it, I will pass this easy freaking, that's not the word I use, exam. And I put it on my wall. And any time that I started to doubt myself, I looked up and I read that and I got a chip back on my shoulder. You know what? I'm doing this. I advise you and I advise all my students to, especially if you don't curse in real life, it's really great to have that bad word on the piece of paper because it's kind of like this shock. Just pull it out whenever you start to get low. And you know what? No, you're doing this. Because a lot of this game, especially come exam time, it's about confidence. And it's like playing a pro sport. You let go of your fear, be reckless, because if you're not, you're going to fail anyway. Just dive in. And again, I'm going to show you how to have a good time. I'm not telling you to dive into a fire pit. So let's talk about the fundamental principle behind Plan 7, which is what I call it now, this methodology. And this is the most important thing I can tell you. And if you don't abide by this principle, God bless America, you're going to be taking the bar exam again. And it's called, I call this time wall theory. And what time wall theory means, it means to perform an activity exclusively. You're not going to do anything else. And what I mean exclusively, in the world of social media and 101 distractions going on at any time and four different screens and all this stuff, my methodology is going to teach you to have a lot of free time. But when you study, or free time for that matter, or you're doing a real life obligation going to the grocery store, you're going to build what I call the time wall around this time. So for example, if you're studying torts and you decide I'm going to study torts for 90 minutes, the computer's off unless you're using it to study. Facebook is and Instagram and TikTok are gone. They're nowhere in your life right now. This is your career on the line. right? It's not time to play. It's not time to try to multitask. Multitasking kills when it comes to the bar exam. K-I-L-L-S, kills. Fastest way to fail is to try to do everything at once all the time. Okay, so the concept, there's three areas to your life this summer. One is your bar exam study time, obviously. Two is your real life obligations. And the third is what I'm going to call, and it's a very important part of this plan, is your me time, M-E time. Okay, as I said, your bar exam study time, I just explained it. You have a wall around it. Whatever you're studying at that time, you're studying. If you're studying and you find yourself not in the zone, you don't want to study, go play a video game. Do something else. Take time out. There's only two modes of studying for the bar exam, all out or don't, right? Period. Black, white, opposites. Study or do not, like Yoda or whoever said once upon a time. Okay, the second category is your real life obligations. Now, everybody thinks when you take the bar exam, real life stops. I can't possibly shop for groceries. I'm taking the bar exam. I can't walk my dog anymore. You know, whatever you imagine. That's not reality at all. If you treat the bar exam like a job, more or less, this all works out. And I'm going to get to scheduling in a second. But the key to this all working is also time wall. So in other words, if you're going to the grocery store and you need all this stuff and you're scared about torts, the answer is not to go to the grocery store with your torts outline. I've done it. Looks ridiculous, gets nothing done, right? The answer is to study torts with the time wall, finish, go to the grocery store, and when you're doing the grocery store, you're in the grocery store, and the bar exam has nothing whatsoever to do with your life. You're not thinking about it. Now, that's not an anti-bar exam sentiment. It's very, very important because the bar exam is not a sprint. It's a marathon. It's very, very important to avoid burnout. It's very, very important to not have your real life go into catastrophe mode because then you will never get to study. So whatever real life obligations you have, dinner with mom, right? Go and take in the kids, whatever. Those exist. You're going to build them in and you're not going to spend that time stressed out about the bar exam. You're going to spend that time in the moment. You're with your kids. Enjoy the time with your kids, whatever it is. Now, the third and final category, and this is where I got a lot of raised eyebrows when I first unveiled this methodology, and then all of a sudden everybody buys into it. What I did is, okay, let me back up a second. When I, Legal Research and Writing, the class where I was doomed, my professor, Robert Brownstone, who's one of the finest lawyers I've ever met and absolutely saved my career that day, he told us at USF, he said, listen, you're new to law school. I highly, highly advise you to take a period of time every week for 3 hours or so to where you don't do law school and guard that time like gold, no matter what. So I took that to heart. So the only time I allowed myself to not be in my berserk study mode for that whole fall semester were 3 hours during the Niner games. And during the Niner games, I was in the Niner game. Maybe not physically present. I had no money at the time, but I was watching the Niner game. I had not a care in the world. The Niner game's over. I'm back in law school mode. I'm refreshed. I'm hyped and I'm happy. I didn't spend the Niner game worried about torts, right? I was cheering for Jerry Rice or whoever it was at the time. Okay. So the time wall theory, as I indicated, is the fundamental principle behind everything that I've talked about. And you're familiar with the mental preparation to get there. Now, let's get into this, to the bar exam itself. Let's start talking about this. Now, there are four parts to the bar exam. There's the MPRE, which you probably studied for one day and took or whatever. It's not really a bump in the road for anybody. Important, I'm not saying it's not important. It's just not difficult. The three main parts that you have to worry about this summer, five essay questions, right? Which It's actually 17 areas of the law that you have to learn. The MBE, which is the multi-state bar exam, the multiple choice. And the third one is the performance test, or the performance exam, which is a whole adventure in and of itself. Now, I'm going to talk about all three parts, and I'm going to cut to the chase. And I highly advise you to just listen and take notes and think about this, because this method works. It is different than what you're going to learn from other people, perhaps. But I know it works, and I will explain exactly why. Now I'm rambling. Okay. Killing the MBE. What is it? It's 200, as you know, probably know by now, hopefully, 200 multiple choice questions, right? Seven areas of the law. 25 of those questions don't count for whatever reason, which is another irrelevant fact, has no purpose. You're never going to figure out during the time span of the bar what is going to count or not. It's crazy. So for your purposes, there's 200 questions, full stop. Now, the key to the MBE is to realize that very, very smart people design these questions so that very, very, very smart people cannot answer them. They're very, very hard. Now, traditional belief is to look at each question and focus on the substantive law and think it through and then go to the next question. And then that's your process. That's your traditional method. And of course, the legal analysis is part of it. But I'm going to teach you a different way to look at this. In my experience, so whatever the percentages are now, I'm not quite clear, but they used to say, if you get around, 80 to 90 percentile, you might do so well, the rest of the bar exam won't matter, you're passed. And whether that's true or not, I don't know, but I took that to heart. So I dove into the MBE. And what I realized very early in the game, it's not like looking at flashcards in the first year where you're going to look at this torts question and think it through. You don't have time. That time does not exist on the bar exam. I mean, it's just a fact. You won't finish it, right? So the key to success, and you're going to hear me say this concept a couple of times, and this is where I deviate from everybody, but listen, hear me out. It's answer pattern recognition. I call it APR, answer pattern recognition. Okay. And it's basically, and I'm going to explain how to get there. It's basically training your mind and your brain to instantly know where these examiners are going and instantly be able to knock out a lot of the questions without even thinking about it. It sounds impossible or not intuitive. So here's how to do that. Here's how to absolutely kill the MBE. For reference, my MBE, I tracked my percentages very closely. I got up to 98% before the bar exam, which I think is unheard of. Interestingly enough, the night before the bar exam in San Jose, all of a sudden I was in the 40% range, but I realized, okay, I've either gone stupid, which is bar exam doesn't matter, or I've overstudied. So I threw all my books away, literally threw them in the garbage. I watched a movie and smooth sailed. It came back. It wasn't as scary as it was for about 5 minutes. Okay. So here's the 7 golden rules for the MBE. If you follow these rules, you will knock it out. End of story, full stop. Okay, rule 1, start fast and start early. The minute that you are aware of the existence of MBE questions, whether you're in your first year of law school or you're today getting ready to take the bar exam, the minute that enters your consciousness, you're going to figure out where to get sample questions immediately. Now, if you're taking the summer-long class, maybe you already have that. Awesome. Now, you're going to ignore, if you're early in the game, you're going to ignore the fact that it feels like the bar exam is 700 years away and multiple choice is easy. That is a recipe for doom, to fall into that trap of thinking like that, right? Developing answer pattern recognition for the MBE, it's like learning to parlo italiano, to speak Italian. You cannot do it in one day. It is impossible. You cannot cram it. It's a process, and you start as early, like a Formula One race car driver. You step on the gas right off the bat and you go. Now, the minimum, if you say, well, what's the minimum? The minimum time you should be spending, in my opinion, on MBE, and this is your block, right, is 90 minutes, period, every day, every day. Not only, there's no Saturday and Sunday here, every day. Now, when you do that 90 minutes, you're going to build a time wall around your MBE time, as I spoke about before. All distractions go. People, objects, social media, whatever it is, ciao, get out of the room for a little bit. Now, rule three is optional, but I discovered that the only legal studying that makes any sense on a commute, if you're on a bus, a subway, carpool, the only thing that's effective that works, it's not trying to do an outline or an essay or a performance exam, impossible, MBE. So I call it the commute rule. If you have a commute, I used to take the train from near the beach in San Francisco to downtown. It was almost an hour each way. Instead of sitting there and looking out the window, I added 2 hours a day to MBE time before I even sat in the class or whatever. So the commute rule. Rule four. Okay, so here we are. We're ready to dive into the MBE. Rule four, and this goes for every section of the bar exam, I call focus first. Whenever you open the exam, whatever it may be, MBE, essays, whatever, the first thing you do is not grab your pencil or pen or keyboard and go as fast as you can and panic, because you have that time. You have time to center yourself, whether it's 30 seconds, a minute, 5 minutes, you don't need that long, but just saying, if you don't have that time, you were never going to pass anyway. And I don't mean to be sarcastic. Take the time, take a breath. Everybody starts riding around you. It's all good. Get in your zone. Okay, here I go. I'm going to do this. Now, the answer pattern recognition, when you're developing it, every day, here's where my technique differs to get this drilled into your head. You're going to, let's say you have 100 sample questions. You're not going to do 100 sample questions. You're going to do 10. In blocks of 10, you're never going to do more than 10. You're going to do 10 at a time. After the 10, when you finish, whatever your answers are, you're going to stop. You're going to go to the back of the book or wherever it is in the PDF, and you're going to read the correct answer. Do not waste time reading anything that is not correct. Who cares? You know, that some examiner made it up. It's nonsense anyway. Read the correct answer. Right? You're developing answer pattern recognition. Trust me on this. You're going to read the correct answer. This takes time. It feels like busy work. It feels like, oh my God, you know, I could skip the answer. I just need to get more quick. No. Proceed at your peril without reading the answers. Now, and that should be for every MBE question. Now, rule six, in the MBE, this is what trips a lot of people up. I call it the MBE landmine. And rule six is to disarm the MBE landmine. And what does that even mean? Well, that means a question that is made so impossibly hard that it is scientifically designed that most of you guys who are the smartest, brightest, best we have are not going to get it right. Right? Now, the way that you could throw yourself out of the game very quickly is to come across one of these questions and to spend 10 minutes in panic and stare at it and try to delve into that policy discussion of Civ Pro in year two or blah, blah, blah. When you hit that question, if you've done the preparation early, like I'm suggesting, and in the exactly the manner I'm saying, when you get that question, you're going to know it. You're going to know it's screwed up. And here's how to get past that. First thing you do is you look at it, you eliminate any wrong answers. Anything you know is wrong, cross it out, get rid of it, anything. If it's one answer, great. You've at least minimized the pool of what you can pick from. Then pick the correct answer. If you're still baffled after that, look at it one more time and one more time only. Cross out any wrong answers, then pick the right answer. So you've done that process twice. Wrong answer out, pick. Can't, okay, repeat it. When you repeat it, if you still don't know, guess. Make the most ridiculous, wild guess you can. Flip a coin, use astrology. It doesn't matter, but you got to keep going. Just pick your answer. God bless America. Ciao, everybody. Go to the next question. If you stay there, you're doomed. Okay? Now, Rule seven is for the first month of this game, when you start doing the MBE, your success rate could be abysmal, probably will be abysmal, ridiculously abysmal. Like you're going to look at this and go, how? I got 7% correct. Great. I can be a lawyer in Antarctica, maybe, right? It's not going to work. So for 1 month, who cares? Don't even think about it. And the reason is, like I said, when you're learning Italian, for example, or Spanish or anything, it takes time to ramp up. You could study 12 hours in one day. It's not going to make you fluent. Same with these questions. It's going to build up, build up, build up, build up, build up. Now, if you've done the technique that I'm telling you, over this period of time, the answers are inherently going to be ingrained in your conscience. It's going to be the craziest thing. It's going to be like an AI voice in your ear. And when you're doing this, certain questions, a lot of questions, more than you think, are going to follow exact patterns that you've seen many times before. And when you hit that question and the answer pattern is immediate, you're going to knock it out immediately. You're just going to go, done. Well, the great thing about that, if you do the math, which I'm not going to do right now, that buys you a ton of time on everything else. I finished the MBE like 20 minutes early. It was ridiculous. I scanned once more, bye. I'm not a genius. I'm not anything. It's just, if you do this technique and you're relentless, you cannot do too many MPE questions, period, period. In fact, if you have a whole day, if you really want to do yourself a favor that you will be thanking for your, you know, all summer, thanking yourself, this Saturday, next Saturday, take the entire day and do MBE. Then have a pizza and wine at the end of it, whatever. The more time you put in now, the better your experience will be. And once it gets drilled in, it's automatic. I wasn't even thinking at the time with the MBE. I was so fast getting on that. Okay, that concludes the MBE portion of the festivities. I told you the techniques. The most important thing is speed. Hit it hard, hit it fast, and the answer pattern recognition. Now, let's talk about the essay questions. Act two of the summer's fun festivities. Okay. Strategic preparation for the essays. To summarize, the level of detail in an essay exam on the bar exam is far less than you had in law school. So that's an important concept because there's too many subjects, right? You would explode people's head. You'd have like three lawyers in the United States. So it doesn't go to level 10. It goes to maybe level 4. So the way that you could really get overwhelmed and screw this up is to be under the impression that the more study materials you have, the better. Right? So you're going to bring in your law school notes and you're going to have the 15 different study guides, different colors and companies and whatever, and blah, 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 blah. You don't need any of that, right? No. You need, if you're going to your bar review class, which I told you you have to do, they're going to tell you exactly what you need. Your law school notes, throw in the lake. If you're going to use them, you might need them once all summer, maybe, because your professor explained something really well and you want to just tap into that. Forget the rest of it, right? It's not a tool right now at this time. So preparing for the essay questions. Number one is to repeat the time wall. When you're working on the essays, you're working on the essays. There's nothing else going on. Enough said. Now, here's the strategic secret to the essay exams. So I, in my book, I do a little diagram, but I'm going to explain this. It's very simple. So when you go into your class, let's say Torts is 3 days. Signing in the Zoom or you're going into the ballroom, whatever it is, Torts is 3 days. So in traditional law school, you go to Torts for 3 days, you throw your notes on the shelf, and then you're in the land of Civ Pro for 3 days, and the circus continues all summer or all semester. And then towards the end of the semester, you scramble and you make an outline and you take your test. That once you get through a couple of years of law school, that's what it becomes, right? So if you do that technique, if you take that law school mentality to the bar exam, probably about week seven, you're going to have a nervous breakdown. I mean, literally, you're going to need help, because it's just not possible to process that much information and create outlines at a high speed at the end when all the stress hits. It you'll spiral. So the way to do it is this. Torts class one. Okay, let's just pretend. Here's my notes from Torts class one. On computer or physical, same concept. Now, when I get my notes from Torts class one, if they're physical notes, that night, that day, same day, red alert, emphasis, stars, same day, you're going to take these notes, you're going to put them, type them into your outline that you're going to use to study for the bar exam. If you're on computer already, okay, that's a step easier. You're going to clean it up. The goal is when you're done with Torts one out of three, that day's notes, that you can take this, your notes, goodbye, because if you have to refer to that later, you're doomed. Okay. Now, so if you do this technique, Torts one, boom, outline's ready to go. Torts two, boom, outline's ready to go. Torts three, done, ready to go. From that day for the rest of the summer, right? Important concept. Think about this. You don't need to look at anything else for Torts. You don't need to look at your notes. You don't need to look at some stupid study guide. You don't need to look at anything. You have a closed universe of everything that you physically need to know for Torts for your exam. If you do that with every subject, by the time you get to the end of the summer, when it's time to, okay, here we go, I have to study do or die time, you're going to have a set of perfect study materials. That panic phase when you realize you have to create it, it's gone. It never happened. You're cool. You're a cool cucumber, hanging out, having a good time, ready to go, right? The secret is don't get lazy. Just say, okay, whatever it takes, because if you wait, it's not going to be fresh. It's going to take you twice as long anyway. That day, your notes go into your outline, and whatever notes you had, throw them away. And if you're too paranoid to do that, put them away. Where you could get them later if your all computers blow up or whatever you're afraid of, right? But that is, you have to move on and close the universe. Okay, now, excuse me. The key to passing and doing well on the essay exams, and here's another point where my plan deviates from traditional thought. In my view, the key is muscle memory, right? You need to get 17 outlines into your hands so that you could reproduce them at will, by instinct, ready to go. Because, as you know, and we'll talk about more in a second, the name of the game in law school and the bar exam is not spouting out your outline. That gets you the ticket to the ball or whatever. That's nothing. It's your analysis is what they grade, right? So you have to get these outlines in your head. So when you think about it, it's almost an insurmountable task. It's absolutely insane. And if you do the technique of staring and reading at your outline, first, you're doing nothing for the muscle memory. And second, I don't know that that's completely possible to do quickly. So what I did is the following, and this works spectacularly well. So back to Torts. Let's pick on Torts today. So Torts one, two, and three, I went to the class, watched the video, my outline's done, I'm ready to roll, and I'm moving into other subjects. Okay, now I want to start memorizing Torts, because I know at the last 2 weeks, if I don't know Torts, it's going to get ugly. It's going to be a disaster. So instead of staring at your outline, what I did was I wrote out my outline every day, whatever it was. If you are going to take the bar exam on computer, which is more likely these days, that it would involve typing out your outline. Now, in the beginning of this process, it's very wordy. It's your hand's going to fall off a little bit. It's whatever. As you start to, okay, I know the prima facie case of this. I know the elements of this. As you start to do this through the course of the summer and you're writing your outlines, you're typing, you're going to find, oh, I can write the acronym and everything else will just flow. And that's the process. Your outlines are going to get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. Now, by allowing your outline to organically transform like this and typing it or writing it, the skill set that you're going to need when that bar examiner goes, go, you're going to, when you get all of a sudden panic, oh my God, my entire legal career is on it, blah, blah, blah. It's going to be drilled into you and literally drilled into you already. And at least the outline portion of that, there is going to be no chance for you to blank or to not be able to put coherent thoughts in terms of the outline. Now, I'll talk about one more thing that I see. I might have a question here. So the school of thought for outline exams, the traditional school of thought, is to take as many as possible. Okay, here's your hour and a half or not, whatever it is, time limit, ready, go, take the exam, and you're writing feverishly and you're trying to do it and you're writing it all out and God bless America, you did it. Now, the problem with that is with the time span that you have this summer, you do not, in my opinion, have time to do enough repetitions for answer pattern recognition, there's that concept again, to kick in, right? And to, for you to be familiar with all the potential derivatives that could hit you and that you'd be ready to respond with. So what I suggest and my method is one, as I just described, getting the outline in your hands, whether that's typing or writing through the process of the summer. You're not just staring at it, you're getting it in your hands. Second is, don't take practice exams. Now, don't get me wrong. If you need to take one or two to get in the mode of, oh, okay, I felt like I had the real time experience, I know I could do it, great. But what you need to do is you need to get a hold of as many practice exams as possible. Do not take the whole practice exam, but you're going to read it and then you're going to outline it. And you're going to outline your answer, which is A, going to be your outline that's in your head. And then B, as much as you need to write to figure out how you would answer that effectively when you do write it out. When you get to that point, when you know you can do it, move on. Because if you spend the summer writing out answer after answer after answer, you're going to get 50 done when you should have done 500. So stick, save the busy work and the carpal tunnel syndrome or whatever it is for your hand. Save that for later, right? Do only as many practice exams as you need to get a grip on the time constraints and then forget it. I think I did one practice exam the whole time for essays. I was not into it. I was doing outline after outline after outline after outline. I was reading past exams, busy work, not into it. I don't have time. Okay. So let me just look at this question real quick. For already existing attorneys barred in other states, do you suggest taking the full bar or just the California attorney's exam? I don't know the answer to that yet. Should students take an early bar prep program? Absolutely, you cannot not take a bar prep program. There is no downside, absolutely no downside, except if you get in a class that focuses primarily on busy work, where you're writing a lot and not getting the actual answer pattern recognition, because busy work, I proved at year one of law school, busy work isn't gonna get you very far. It's working smart, not hard. So let's talk about tactical execution. You get the essay exams. What's going on? Okay, time limit, time management. I misspoke before. You have an hour. Okay, great. You open it up. First rule, focus first, right? You have enough time to take a deep breath, look around, whatever you need to do. If you're panicked, think about baseball. Just check out for a second, relax, take command of what you're doing. Okay, second thing, you go. Now, you remember IRAP, issue, rule, analysis, conclusion, right? Issue and the rule, great. They're in here because you have the outline in your hands. You're going to get that done and move off of it. Now, the killer analysis. If you got C's in law school, there's only one reason, and it's because you were really, really focused on writing out the rule and writing out statutes from memory, which is a skill that Google made irrelevant a long time ago, right? So you have to focus on the analysis. That needs to be all of your effort into the analysis. The conclusion, right? Forget the idea that you're going to come up with the correct conclusion for any answer on the bar exam. You're going to argue what you think is the best answer, your conclusion, and then when you're done, you're going to briefly CYA. You're going to argue the other side. But on the other hand, a court could rule because you don't know what the bar examiner is thinking. And good lawyers do this anyway. You want to cover both avenues and make sure that that's in there. You don't want to say, this is the only way it could be done. It's not what lawyers do. Okay. Well, that's questions. Okay. Let's talk about the performance exam here. Okay, this is the third part of the bar exam. Cue the evil music, as I like to say. This is the part that tends to make people fail, simply put. There's two parts to the performance exam. Case file, which is a bunch of papers, right? Just tells you what the case is about, what the law you're going to use is. It's a closed universe, so you don't have to know any other law, in theory, other than what's in this package they give you. And you are could be asked to do anything, right? You might say, like, write a legal memo, a brief, an affidavit, a closing argument, discovery, witness interviews, negotiate. The list is endless, all right? So that should tell you, okay, if the list is endless, there's a common denominator, right? Okay. Because we're smarter than them. We're going to figure this out. So I had a class for the bar exam and for the performance exam part of the bar exam. And the wrong way to do, again, getting like the essay exams, what we did in our class was we took the performance exam and then we had to write the whole thing out. And then if you failed the exam, you had to write the whole thing out again. Well, interestingly enough, in an entire semester, I never passed one performance exam, zero. So going into the bar exam, it was like, well, okay. And I'm not into busy work, so that might be part of it. But I was like, okay, what are we doing here? So to figure this out, what I did is this, same as the essay exams. You need to do as many examples as physically possible over the course of the summer. But writing them out until your hand falls off is a waste of time. And you don't have that time to waste this summer. And you don't. So when you get the example, you're going to identify the category. You're going to think it through. Okay, closing argument. What does that mean? Well, whatever they're asking you to do, you know it's going to involve IRAC, some legal analysis, or what it's the bar exam, right? So, okay, we know that part. So the rest is basically window dressing. If it's an affidavit or if it's a letter to a client, okay, that's easy. You're just going to think this through. So you can identify the category, give a little thought to what is this? Letter to a client. Okay, dear Bob, the client. You're going to outline your answer and then you're going to move on. That's the key, right? Answer pattern recognition. You're training yourself to look at these things quickly, to figure out where you need to go. You know exactly what you're going to write. And then instead of wasting the next 45 minutes, you're going to move on to the next one. And as a result of this game plan, you're going to get so many done. The performance exams, where I never passed any of them until I went to my own strategy. Then I did a couple, I was knocking them out right and left and right and left. I got to the one in the bar exam and it was no big deal. So I'm going to take a few questions. I just want to talk two things very quickly. Then I'm going to take a few questions and then we'll sign off because we're almost out of time. First things first, on Amazon. I have this book, How to Pass the California Bar Exam. It's not expensive. It's not long to read. You can read it in an hour. It's basically this presentation, but a little more in depth. So if you didn't understand something or a little bit, or, oh, I want to read more about how you almost failed out, or it's all in here. Secondly, I wrote a novel, which is going to be a TV series down the road, My Immortal, The Vampires of Berlin. Nothing to do with the law whatsoever, except there's lawyers in it, which is interesting. Okay, so let me look at this. What are the best books for preparation? Question number one. Okay, I'm looking at these questions. What are the best books for preparation? My book, and I don't say that as a book salesman. I'm not the book salesman at all. Start with my book and then look around. But don't get caught up in trying to get book after book after book after book. Start with mine. It's the shortest. And then I think you just go right into your Barbary or bar exam class or whatever it has. Okay, next question. How to train on the essay analytical part to apply the law to the facts. My methodology, that's part of it. The basic concept of applying a lot of the facts, if you're baffled by that, I would get a tutor or look at, or faster yet, study sample answers, right? If you find yourself writing a lot of law, you're running down the wrong road because examiners, they check out when they're reading that anyway. Okay, how do you incorporate your study guide alongside a bar prep program? My study guide is designed to work perfectly with, I took Barbary. I don't even know what exists right now, probably Barbary, maybe some others. It's designed to just go, whoop. There's nothing that in my book that contradicts anything you're gonna get at all, zero. I may have a few different ways to study, right? They might be focused more on the law. I'm telling you, get to the answers. And I know I'm right, but I'm not gonna fight with anybody, but I know I'm right about that. Okay. Can you please clarify the method for MBE regarding answer pattern recognition? I'm sorry, I don't have time for that, but it's in my book. Often the MBEs test on a rule not covered in bar prep materials. What do you suggest doing? If you read the answers, if you follow my technique, this will not be relevant. It'll be covered in the bar prep course, or you'll know how to knock it out. I wouldn't lose any sleep on that. How to improve time management during the bar exam? Time walls. If you do time walls, the crazy thing about time walls, okay, we got about 3 minutes left. My bar exam summer, my parents and everybody imagined that I was just this academic slave and it was terrible and whatever. I lived on Ocean Beach in San Francisco. I took a hour and a half walk every day. I played a couple hours of video games every day. I did an even more extreme version, but I was studying around the clock. It was just me. My fiance went to Japan. It was just me. So I had that luxury where I could just study whenever. But it's really the crazy thing I found out. And the reason I was able to do all those free time things was if you really say subscribe to time wall theory, all of a sudden you have twice as much free time than you thought you had. And you'll have more time, more than enough time. And even if you have a part-time job, whatever, if you don't do time wall and you're just trying to juggling and multitask, it's going to be the most stressful summer you ever had. Do you know how long the class will be? And it's I don't know. Look online. That would be, I think that's how you find that. Okay. Sorry, I didn't do a better job answering these questions, but hopefully that information is online for you. Thank you so much for listening. I hope this was valuable. Like I said, my book is on Amazon. It's in hardcover and Kindle. And if not, best of luck. And don't doubt being a lawyer because there's a lot of incredible things you can do with a law degree that you cannot even imagine right now. So thank you. I'm done.